Dietrich. I am the Global Head of Energy Transition and Strategy for our Commodities and Global Markets Group. I'm based in Houston, and I am delighted to be here this evening to host and participate in our industry roundtable. We have a terrific lineup that's going to join us here in just a moment. But first, I just want to go over, we are going to aim our discussion around three key themes. The first theme is going to be the outlook for low-carbon business opportunities here in the U.S. The second theme is the scale-up of clean energy and other innovative clean technologies. And then the third theme is going to be around the role of partnerships and their importance in enabling ambitious return-driven transition strategies. So if you will, let's welcome our panelists to the stage. Take a seat.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So I am not going to go over the exhaustive Wikipedia bios that I read, and I'm just going to give a really brief intro here so that we can get to a lot of content that we have in our session. So we have Jennifer Von Bismarck. Jennifer is a founding partner and CEO of Galway Sustainable Capital, where she co-leads the company's efforts to originate and underwrite transactions in sustainable credit. We have Richard Fruehauf. Rich is the head of strategy and sustainability at U.S. Steel and is responsible for creating and driving U.S. Steel's strategy and sustainability priorities. And then we have Jan Huckfeldt. Jan is the chief commercial officer at Climeworks and is leading Climeworks' overall commercial business, including what I understand to be a very keen focus on demand side and corporate partnerships. So welcome and thank you all for joining us. All right, so we're just gonna start out and talk a little bit about business models and strategies and how each of you see the low-carbon opportunities from your vantage point. And Jennifer, I'm going to start with you. You've been looking at low-carbon investment opportunities in the U.S. for many years and through several policy cycles, and now through Galway, you focus on filling that capital void for early-stage commercialization and deployment. So tell us a bit about your journey in finance and your journey in investing and how you moved into focusing on investing in sustainability and co-founding Galway and how you got to what I understand to be your dream job.
Yes, thank you. Well, thank you for having us here. And our trip through investing and coming into the sustainability space started out in traditional finance. And I have worked in specialty finance and structured finance for over 20 years and really came at this, you know, evaluating contracts, evaluating risk, making investments. And through that activity, I started looking at opportunities in the U.S. where could you find attractive, credit-worthy, long-term contractual revenue streams? And you know, we were investing some things in the ag space and looking at contracts with the USDA, between the USDA and farmers. And that led us into looking at more things more like solar leases and wind farm royalties. And it was sort of like a light went on, and we started looking at the whole clean energy industry and how in the United States it's rationalized by utilities who are investment grade signing long-term contracts to buy power, and we really liked that. And then what we found in doing that was that there was a gap in the capital market, and that always made us excited because that's where we could find risk-adjusted return. And the gap was that a large utility-scale project could get financing. They could, you know, needed a couple $100 million, people would look at that opportunity. A smaller company with the same technology, the same, you know, the same construction firm, the same O&M provider, but only needing $10 or $20 million could not get financing. So the credit attributes were the same, but the capital wasn't there. And so we found that we could come into those projects and make investments and get attractive risk-adjusted returns on a relative basis. As we started doing that, we also realized that we were catalyzing a lot of small businesses to become bigger businesses, and that's what was exciting to us. And so what we've done in the last 3 years since founding Galway Sustainable Capital is really focus on building a specialty finance company that can programmatically identify these, not first of their kind projects, but second or third of their kind projects, and provide that capital that gets them started. It's very hard to do smaller transactions, but if we find good sponsors and we can do their first project, their second, their third, and amortize our underwriting over a larger stream of projects, we can both have a profitable business, but also have a growing impact in the type of investments that we make.
Yeah, and what struck me, having problems with my microphone, was the focus on the quantitativeness of, you know, your process and how you filter. I mean, you told me, how many transactions do you guys look at a year and how many do you actually do?
We, we look at hundreds and hundreds of transactions, and we have a fairly quantitative filter. And you know, there's been some confusion, I think, in the marketplace around what's an impact investment, what's an ESG investment, and what do we do? What is sustainable infrastructure? And what we do is we filter all of our investment opportunities for having a sufficient impact on the environment, or you know, some sort of social or environmental benefit, so that the opportunities that we're actually seriously evaluating has already cleared that first hurdle. And that means within the things we're seriously looking at, we're trying to maximize our risk-adjusted return. So we like to have an impact, but we really are a returns-based investor.
And how do you feel about the outlook as you see the landscape right now and the outlook for the things that you're focused on?
This is an incredibly exciting time, and Climate Week is so fun to come to New York and see all of the different companies and all of the different solutions that are mm-hmm. getting scaled up. What we like to do is think about themes of transition and then look for the companies who we think are well-placed within those themes, and then try to find them right after their first project is proven out and bring them through second, third, fourth, and so forth. And this is a really exciting time. The Inflation Reduction Act has created a lot of tailwinds and a lot of enthusiasm. Mm-hmm. Smaller businesses are able to get letters of intent. They're able to get some equity funding. And that's what sort of puts them on the path to viability. And once they can clear the proof of concept hurdle, then we can take it from there.
So companies in so-called hard-to-abate sectors, which typically include steel,
are said to be amongst the biggest beneficiaries of the Inflation Reduction Act. But in your case, U.S. Steel had already adopted a net zero target and committed to a pretty ambitious transition strategy prior to the IRA. So tell us about U.S. Steel's journey, and as you do that, what have been the main drivers and enablers to have you make those commitments?
Sure. Well, thanks for having us. We are one of the hard-to-abate sectors. Mm-hmm. But I always like to tell people, although we're part of the problem, we're part of the solution as well. So we started about 4 or 5 years ago with a change in our strategy, and that change really focused on how we produce steel. So historically, U.S. Steel produced steel with what you would all imagine, the blast furnaces, a lot of heavy greenhouse gas emissions, and we started migrating our production to electric arc furnaces, which is really where you take scrap steel, old cars, old washing machines, old bridge girders, then you remelt it. And the beauty of steel is that you can recycle it infinitely and it doesn't lose any of its properties. By doing that, you also reduce the greenhouse gas emissions. So it's about a 75% reduction in the greenhouse gas emissions per ton of steel produced by moving to electric arc furnaces that basically, as the name suggests, use lots of electricity to liquefy scrap steel. And if your power source is nuclear, I used to work in the nuclear industry, so I'm pro-nuclear, but or renewable, you have zero scope two. Your scope one is very low from recycling that steel, and you can produce virtually any kind of steel by recycling old steel. It's also good business, though. It's a much more cost-effective, it's the circular economy, it's more cost-effective, we have a better, less capital intensity with these electric arc furnaces versus our blast furnaces. And so we embarked on this change in strategy. We call it our best of both, because we still run blast furnaces, but we've shifted more of our production to electric arc furnaces. So we began that strategy change before the Inflation Reduction Act, and we made some investments. We will soon be producing about 6 million tons of electric arc furnace steel in Arkansas. We will have a 250 megawatt solar field helping to power that through our utility partner, Entergy, which also runs nuclear to help power that steel production. And we've been generally shifting more and more of our production that way. And we found a lot of receptivity from the market. We see customers, you know, if you hear automotive companies talk about how they're going to go green or green their supply chain, I can tell you the first company they come talk to is their steel supplier, and they say, help us do that. And so we've been working with automotive companies for many years to reduce their, to improve their fuel efficiency to meet CAFE standards, but also to now start producing greener steel products. So, for example, we've partnered with General Motors to produce a green steel product, a low carbon emission steel product we call Verdex. And so we see the customer demand. We see the opportunity to reduce our capital intensity, to improve our cost structure, but also to do good, to do well by doing good.
And when the Inflation Reduction Act was mandated, has that changed anything in your outlook?
I would say it only reinforces it, and I think hopefully will accelerate it. You know, in the Inflation Reduction Act, there is a decarbonization, industrial decarbonization program. It's about $5.8 billion set aside for grant funding for, you know, steel, paper, some of the other hard-to-abate sectors. And that's a new tool that the U.S. government, in particular the Department of Energy, hasn't had previously. They've had the Loan Program Office, you know, low-interest loans, but this is now grant funding up to 50% of a project, which is, I think, something we've not had in the U.S. The Europeans have had for some time, and I think that offers us a lot of opportunity. We submitted concept papers in April.
All right, great. Well, let's pause there for a second, and let's move over to carbon removal and the carbon removal industry. So, Jan, you lead commercial engagement at one of the most innovative climate technology companies possibly in the world, focusing on direct capture of CO2 from the air, direct air capture, also known as DAC. The IRA is the first major policy globally to put some really serious money into enabling the scale-up of DAC. And I believe Climeworks announced a pivot to the U.S. just weeks after the IRA was passed. So walk us through that Climeworks expansion. And as part of that, you know, is this a breakthrough for enabling the scale-up of DAC?
Yeah, thank you for having me. It clearly is a breakthrough. I mean, this is catalytic. And you know, listening to the policymaker earlier, I can only agree to what he said. And there are early, I mean, first of all, what does it mean for Climeworks? We actually made proposals for three direct air capture hubs in the US, and we were selected for all three. That doesn't mean at this stage that the award is flowing, but we are then going into the actual negotiation for the award, and inevitably the Department of Energy will want to see us acting and moving fast now. And that's exactly what we are doing. So the three locations are Louisiana, which is the furthest developed in terms of project, in terms of technical readiness, we are furthest there. There is one in North Dakota and another one in California. And in Louisiana, that's a particularly interesting project. We are doing this together with a partner, Battelle, and another carbon dioxide removal company, Heirloom, which is sitting in California. They have a totally different technology. But we are partnering at this direct air capture hub in Louisiana. And Louisiana is, and we heard it earlier, the social aspect of actually creating a carbon valley, of creating a new industry in Louisiana is very important because it is an underprivileged area. There will be reskilling of workers. We are in the first immediate term, we will need hundreds of engineers and people who actually help us construct this and get going.
And I think you skipped over the fact that you already have a DAC facility operational in Iceland.
In Iceland.
I think that's right.
Yeah, thank you.
And you've been doing this for a dozen plus years already, right?
In fact, we are the only one, the only direct air capture company today who actually have an operation running. We do this for 2 years exactly now.
That's a pretty big deal.
And that's a pretty big deal. It's a pretty big deal because you actually need to get out of your lab. If you do this in a lab, you have a good understanding of the thermodynamics. You have an idea of what it might cost. But when you do it in real life, then the actual really hard work starts because you do it in real conditions. In Iceland, inevitably, needless to say, you have by times, I'm not familiar with the Fahrenheit, but minus 20 degrees and the wind howling, and you need to still be operating. And when you think of operating any manufacturing, costs immediately go up if your availability is not up, if your performance, the speed of your line is not there, and if your output is not in check, right? And so, let's say, in all areas, you're actually first of a kind plant, you get to 80%, while the overall equipment effectiveness, a product of those, is just 50%. So here you can see just, you know, taking these simple figures just to show just how tough that is. And so we've made a lot of progress, and our next plant is actually going to be just besides the one which we have in Iceland, is a 10x larger, and that is going to go on air in January next year.
So when you think about the U.S. climate environment,
this is for each, actually, and you think about just maybe a short view here to squeeze this question in, is policy, are we doing enough? Is the U.S. government doing enough? Is the IRA enough? I have to ask the question.
Well, I mean, first of all, it's as I said, it's catalytic, right? So, I mean, this is so critical for a nascent industry like direct air capture. But to answer your question honestly, it is not enough because more needs to be done. And certain things need to come at a certain time. But obviously, when you look into how solar grew, one can learn quite a lot of it. It's not exactly the same because there it's about electrons and here it's about molecules, which is probably a bit more complex. But still, we can learn a lot from what solar has been done. And their policy can actually, and governments can actually start by purchasing themselves, let's say the defense ministry, purchasing carbon removal, right? So that could be one way of doing it. Then it certainly is a question also of tightening the screws and slowly moving from a voluntary market to a compliance market. Now, why do I say slowly? Because if they were doing it fast, we would actually very quickly run into a big problem because there is simply not enough capacity in carbon dioxide removal out there. So this needs to be a slow transition, but a very important transition. And then, you know, maybe there is need of having a carbon price.
All right, so let's pivot just a little bit and move deeper into decarbonization and clean energy innovation. So we start from focusing on 24/7 clean power. We now go into investments with direct air carbon capture, clean hydrogen, nuclear fusion. There have been many headlines over the recent period suggesting that we're starting to make meaningful progress on the new phase of decarbonization solutions. And we talked about hydrogen a little bit earlier. And as an example, the IRA was a real, or I think is a real game changer for hydrogen. Really generous tax credits. It makes clean hydrogen an economically viable solution across several applications, or at least that's what it's intended to do. And so, Richard, you know, in thinking about the steel sector, clean hydrogen and carbon capture, they're part of the options that the steel sector has. And, of course, the government, you know, has made transitioning steel one of the strategic priorities. So how do you look at that, and how is U.S. Steel thinking about, you know, some of these, you know, more innovative technologies and investments?
Well, it's a great question. So we've set out a path to 2050. We have a roadmap, climate change roadmap. And in that first decade, we're investing in technologies that are proven technologies, like electric arc furnaces that have been around for 50 or 60 years. But in that second decade, things like hydrogen, and we're not an energy company, we'd be a consumer. We would use hydrogen to reduce iron and replace methane in that process, and you could eventually get to zero emissions steel making if you do that. But it's not a technology issue, it's a business model issue. Is there enough hydrogen, because you would need a lot, and is it cost competitive with natural gas? That's really the issue. And so we've participated with Shell and others in evaluating hydrogen hubs and carbon capture. We would be an off-taker if we were to do that. And we've evaluated and supported these hydrogen hubs under the bipartisan infrastructure law, the $8 billion that's available, those hub applications. We've supported through letters of support and cooperated with a number of the hydrogen hub applications because, again, we'd be an off-taker in the process of reducing iron. You can use hydrogen. But I think that, to me, is more of a business model issue. Mm-hmm. Is it, you know, back to, do you have a producer, an ecosystem, an off-taker? Is there a network? And is it viable? If you look at what the DOE put into the application materials, they're not looking necessarily for revolutionary technologies. They're looking for viable, sustainable business models that use hydrogen. So we are evaluating that. That is a sort of second decade in our journey to net zero because of the need to build out that capacity and those business models. We also are looking at novel technologies like we're partnering with or negotiating a partnership with a company called Carbon Free that will take the off gases from our blast furnaces and through their proprietary process turn them into precipitated calcium carbonate, synthetic limestone. So you're not just pumping it into the ground in old oil and gas wells, you're taking the CO2 and turning it into a valuable product. So we look at that as technologies to allow them to mature, and then we can make informed decisions in that second and third decade as we get to 2050. But you know, with a 75% reduction in greenhouse gas just by switching to proven existing technologies, that's been our focus.
Yeah, that's big. And Jennifer, thinking about Galway and thinking about emerging solutions, and you know, where you guys have been investing, the supply chains and that that ecosystem of participants is not really well defined. You know, how do you like bring that into your portfolio, or how are you thinking about, you know, those types of technologies?
Sure. Well, as I mentioned, we really like to do second of its kind projects. And so what we need to do is a couple of things. There is some concessionary capital. There are green banks. There are foundations and endowments. There are some innovative pools of capital who will look at first of their kind projects. And we will look at graduates from some of those programs and really try to scale them up from there. We've looked at some, you know, we've looked at a bunch of hydrogen projects. We've looked at a lot of the innovative technologies that are coming down the pipeline and benefiting from some of the IRA's policies. At the end of the day, it has to make sense from a risk-adjusted return standpoint. So things like corporations being willing to sign LOIs, sign power purchase agreements, offtake agreements, it's extremely helpful to us because we will look at a lot of transactions that make sense in theory, but until it's proven out, until they actually have contracts signed, the counterparties there, we can't invest. And so, you know, we spend a lot of time looking, and to the extent that there are long-term signals provided by policy or endorsements provided by industry for certain technologies, you know, that's what it takes to get us, you know, over the line.
Jan, maybe over to you. Direct air capture, it's one of the very early stage climate technologies, right? But all the major climate scenarios out there tell us there's no way to tackle climate change, there's no way to get to net zero unless we have negative emissions solutions. So I, for one, don't really have an appreciation for what goes into a DAC project, and I'm not sure if many people here really do. In just a couple of minutes, can you take us through, like, what are the successful parameters in a DAC project? Can you just walk us through that?
Sure. It's a long, long list of things. And inevitably, to make it really simple, you need to have renewable energy, because if you use oil and gas for your process, it defeats the purpose, right? So Climeworks at the moment has maybe a carbon footprint of 15%. So if we take 100 tons out, we basically re-emit 15, so net 85. We, on a good day, we are at 10%, and we know that we can drive this towards 5 or even below. That actually is a proof that it works. In Iceland, we actually chose Iceland for three key reasons. One, there is geothermal energy, Reykjavik capital. The entire city is heated by geothermal energy. They actually need to cool down the water, which comes obviously directly out of the ground, because it's 90 degrees hot. And we can benefit right from this globally biggest geothermal energy source. And that's an important one. Then we need a carbon sink. And in Iceland, it's an ideal situation because there is volcanic rock, basalt rock. And to very quickly explain, we basically adsorb the CO2 with a sorbent. Once our collector containers are saturated, we close them up, we use the geothermal energy to actually reverse that decision, then we get to pure CO2. The CO2 we then turn into a liquid, so from gas to liquid, mix it with water and pump it with a partner company, Carbfix, who is specialized in this, 1,000 meters deep into the basalt rock. And the basalt rock is porous, it's alkaline, and if you drink carbonated water, it's slightly acidic, so you have an acid-base reaction forming a carbonate. Carbonate is, in this case, a calcite. It's like marble, which is formed in geological terms. It's happening very quickly, so within a year or two, you actually get to a mineral. And then it is locked away for thousands of years, right? And that, by the way, is in a very important differentiation between the different carbon dioxide removal methods. Because when we are burning fossil fuels, we are taking out of the long carbon cycle the actual carbon and creating carbon dioxide. If you plant trees, you are in the short carbon cycle, right? So it's very important that we actually drive more and more technologies which actually can permanently lock the CO2 away. Right?
And the way that Climeworks is sort of setting this up, there's modularity.
Yeah.
In the
so,
setup.
Well, it is probably the most scalable technology you can have, because we basically have those container units, and we just need to multiply them, and they surround a process unit, whereby afterwards you actually have the gas and liquid processing happening. And what has to happen from a technology standpoint is that our solvent needs to be ever more efficient, faster, so that these adsorption, desorption cycles are happening in a faster and more efficient way.
All right, so let's pivot again into and talk a little bit about partnerships. So I think we've all kind of touched on, you know, how important it is with the partnerships and between stakeholders and the supply chains. And so when you think about partnerships, can each of you sort of highlight, you know, how you think about partnerships, the importance of partnerships, how you lean on partnerships, you know, in kind of each of your industries? And Rich, you want to
jump in first? Well, I mean, it's absolutely critical for us. So, we have a great partnership with Entergy, which is the utility that supplies power to our Big River facility. As I said, they basically went out and developed this 250 megawatt solar field for us to use the power off of it. But, you know, a lot of our business is really partnership related. So we work very closely with the automotive sector, and they come and they say, well, we have a problem. We need to lightweight the vehicle, so we develop certain grades of steel. Where I brought a little show and tell, you know, if you drive an EV, this is a special kind of steel electric that's called non-grain oriented. It's conductive, it's magnetic for turning the battery power into motion. It's made from recycled steel, but we developed that because of the boom in EVs and other electrification requirements coming from our customers. So I think the problems that we have, whether it's partnering with energy providers or the government, or our customers, you can't solve these. These are ecosystem problems.
Sure. Well, we have partnerships are really important for us as well. And I think one of the partners we think about is our sponsor development partners. And when we think about building a sustainable economy, one of the things that we want to do is actually have investments in companies where the upside, the benefit, the growth, the financial returns are shared with the folks in that location who developed the opportunity. So the way Galway invests, we typically invest preferred or structured equity into project companies. And the project company usually has a parent company, a holdco, an upper tier operating business that has sponsored that development work. And we will have preferred equity into the project co. The upside of that investment, a lot of that accrues to the benefit of the developer. And so again, we're going to do our first project with them, and ideally that will go well, and they will have some upside from that. But if they can do 2, 3, 4, we're actually not only building projects, but we're helping build those businesses, because that financial return stays in that community. It also, a lot of these, as you know, these are, you know, long-term, multi-year projects with long-term cash flow streams. You now have small businesses throughout the United States that are benefiting from this, you know, visibility around cash flows. So they can hire people, and they can innovate, they can do research and development to continue to expand their business. We have, you know, manufacturing facility in Baltimore that's looking at building its next plant in Connecticut. We have data centers in Pittsburgh and Miami that are looking at other areas across the country. And again, as each one of those sites proves itself out, those businesses become part of the sustainable economy. That's part of our strategy.
Yeah, partnerships,
yeah, jump in there.
Are super critical, right? I mean, we are operating in a voluntary market that says it in itself, right? So we need corporations on the offtake side. We need investors, whether this is equity or project investment. And you know, I mean, I don't need to tell you in the room that infrastructure is CapEx thirsty business. This is the case for direct air capture too. And we follow a business model whereby we need to make those bankable, and how do we make them bankable by actually having offtake agreements of future installations so that we can build them in first place. And that's by times tough business. So we are very thankful to the Microsofts and JP Morgans of the world who actually made that bet and are investing and also actually purchasing our removal services.
Yep, and it's a great signal, right? It's a great signal for
Absolutely.
The investment, for the technology, et cetera. All right, so maybe in the last couple of minutes, maybe the key takeaways from each of you as far as, you know, what would you leave this audience with as far as where you're focused, where your outlook is? What do you want to leave them with, Rich?
I think it's a challenging time, but there's a lot of opportunity. You know, when I talk about steel, people are usually shocked. I mean, it is part of the problem, but it's also part of the solution. You can't address climate change. You can't electrify your economy without steel. And I think there's a lot of opportunity. We've invested in electrical steel production, and that was pre-IRA. I think with the IRA and the stimulus that it'll present, things are just going to accelerate. So I think I'm cautiously optimistic.
Jan, how about you?
Well, if you follow science, then by 2050, no matter which strategy we are pursuing, whether it is about massive reduction of energy need or fully going into renewables or relying on removal, we will need removal 5 gigatons, so 5 billion tons a year of capacity, up to 15, depending on what scenario you're looking at. To get there, we need to act now. It's a little bit like a pension scheme. I mean, you're not starting to pay into your pension scheme when you're 50, but you do this right from the beginning, and that's the same here. We need your commitments. We need your offtake agreements to actually get that going. To get to multiple megatons by 2030, hundreds of megatons by 2040, and then billions of tons in 2050. And just to give you an idea, now we are moving towards megatons. One coal plant is emitting 2 megatons a year, just to give you a little bit of an idea of how much of a scaling actually needs to be done. And it is absolutely vital that we get there.
And Jennifer, we're going to end it with your takeaway.
Sure. Well, at Climate Week, I think we sit in a lot of panels and we hear people talking about the need to act, and this is where, you know, these are our goals for 2030, our goals for 2050. And I think the question in your mind as an audience member is always, but how, what are we supposed to do, you know, how do we do it? And as a specialty finance company and an investor, I always think about how do you do new things and still manage risk, because we don't like to take risk. And what I think has been exciting about this year's Climate Week, we've heard a lot about, again, the really building a daisy chain of capital, again, from first of its kind project financing, put that with concessionary capital and green banks and folks who can handle that risk, and then bring the scale up into companies like Galway, who can really, with partnerships, help grow businesses by building their next series of projects. And then we have a fantastic partnership with Macquarie, and graduates from Galway will be great partners for Macquarie to make that ubiquitous. And I think if you want to see what a sustainable economy looks like and how do we get there, it's really understanding the pathway from innovation to scale up to, you know, broad distribution. And I hope people leave with a sense that there is actually a tactic for achieving those goals. And a lot of the supportive partners are in this room, and there's a lot of really exciting things happening.